Hi, it's Dr. Centeno, and I'd like to introduce you to some interesting and really critical new data on craniocervical instability diagnosis. So craniocervical instability, or also called CCJ instability, means that the upper neck bones move around too much due to damaged or loose ligaments. And there's lots of different ligaments up there. We're going to really focus today more on the alar ligaments. So one of the problems, however, with diagnosing craniocervical instability that's usually not talked about very often is that patients without CCI may also have similar measurements to patients with CCI. So when we do things like a Grabb-Oakes or a powers ratio or a clivoaxial angle, there's some mixture there between patients who are totally normal and have no issues, but will have abnormal measurements, and patients who have craniocervical instability who have abnormal measurements. And so the problem has always been trying to find a measurement that normal people don't have at all. And I think that may have been done, and that's why this is so exciting, based on a new study looking at digital motion X-ray or DMX. So there are two types of imaging that can suggest craniocervical instability. One is static or not moving. The other is dynamic or moving. Obviously, a static image would be something like just a routine MRI where you're lying face up in a tube and they go ahead and do your image. Dynamic would be something like DMX or a movement-based MRI where you're moving around and they're taking pictures. One of the ways, and I've been talking about that we can look at dynamic imaging is something called the DMX or digital motion X-ray. And that's merely an X-ray while you're moving your neck around. So it looks something like this. You can see the patient moving. Hence, you know that the ligaments are supposed to prevent certain movements. So the goal here is to try to see if things move too much. Now, this has got a distinct advantage over a static image like an MRI when the patient's lying face up. Number one is the patient is actually seated or standing when they're getting this image, so it's weight-bearing. Hence, it's more likely to show issues. And number two, the other big advantage is the patient is moving. And instability is a dynamic, not a static concept, meaning if something is unstable, it's unstable when it moves. It's not unstable just sitting there. So a new study has finally determined normal values for DMX. We've been waiting for this study for a long time. I've been involved with it off and on really for the last decade of trying to get this project moving and trying to get enough normal patients imaged. And it was finally published by Freeman and Katz. There's the citation off to the right there. And the measurement we're going to be looking at today is a measurement of the alar ligament. The alar ligament comes from the dens, as you can see here. So the dens is this tooth-like process right there. And you can see these yellow ligaments coming from either side, going from that dens up to the skull. So that's called the alar ligament. And the new measurement involves the periodontal space, which is shown here, and C1, C2 overhang, which I'll show on the next slide. So the periodontal space is what I have here. It's the distance between the C1 bone and that C2 bone on either side, and it should be identical or close to identical on left and right as you move. That means that the alar ligament is doing its job. Now, in C1, C2 overhang, that's actually when you tilt your head to the right or to the left. Does C1 move out too far or move out at all versus C2? So you can measure that right here. You can see that the C1 is overhanging the C2 when the person bends to one side. So that's why we call it overhang. Now, what was interesting about these two measurements is that this new study found that if C1, C2 overhang is more than 2 millimeters and the periodontal space was abnormal, meaning that one side was bigger than the other, then there was 100% accuracy with a 0% false positive rate in picking out traumatic injuries from normal patients. That's a very big deal. It's extremely rare that any imaging test at all has 100% accuracy. Almost always there's some crossover in patients who don't have the disease but still have that imaging finding. So this is truly remarkable, I think, showing the value of DMX and showing the value of diagnosing craniocervical instability this way. And I suspect that even though this was done in traumatic patients, that this likely applies to patients with EDS and other types of connective tissue disorders. So for more information, contact the CCJ Instability Institute at CentenoSchultz.com. And we can obviously order a DMX if you don't have one. They have these units all over the country. And I think this is extremely important information for all patients who suffer from craniocervical instability or are really struggling to try to get a diagnosis. So thanks so much for watching and have a great day.